Good afternoon, and welcome to the Afterlife of the Humanities Major, an event to mark the release of the State of the Humanities 2021, Workplace and Beyond, the latest report from the American Academy's Humanities Indicators. The American Academy is proud to be co-hosting this program with our colleagues at the National Humanities Center. I want to take the opportunity to welcome the guests of the National Humanities Center who are here today, as well as the American Academy Fellows and affiliate representatives who have joined us. It will come as no surprise that there is a significant overlap among our organization's constituencies, and it is a pleasure to be all together virtually for today's conversation. Since our founding in 1780, the American Academy has been deeply committed to exploring and elevating the humanities. In our capacity as an honors society, we elect and award scholars from across all humanities disciplines. In our role as an independent research center, we strive to always include a humanistic perspective in our cross-disciplinary work and have frequently studied the humanities directly. Recent projects have included the Commission on the Humanities and Social Sciences and the Commission on Language Learning, in addition to our longstanding Humanities Indicators project. The Humanities Indicators began its work in the early 2000s and now exists on the Academy website, providing nonpartisan statistical information on the health of the humanities in five areas: primary and secondary education, undergraduate and graduate education, research and funding, the workforce, and humanities in American life. This research is made possible by the generous support of the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation. The report we are discussing today, The State of the Humanities 2021, Workplace and Beyond, raises interesting questions about how to measure the value of a college degree. Based largely on original research commissioned by the American Academy, this new publication examines a variety of outcome measures, including graduates' satisfaction with their jobs, their finances, and their lives more generally. Among its conclusions, the report finds that although humanities majors may tend to earn less than many business and STEM majors, they report similarly high levels of satisfaction to graduates from almost every field with respect to their careers and lives. In analyzing data on both the tangible and intangible benefits of a college education, we are hopeful that the report provides a starting point for a more nuanced discussion about the relationship between study, employment, and quality of life for humanities majors. Given the seeming disparity between objective measures of income and subjective measures of satisfaction, which should be valued more? How can champions of these disciplines better articulate the benefits of the humanities degrees to skeptical audiences? And what can universities and employers alike do to better support humanities majors in their lives after graduation? To discuss these and other questions, we're so pleased to be partnering with the National Humanities Center for today's conversation. The National Humanities Center is the nation's only independent institute dedicated exclusively to advanced study in all areas of the humanities. Our two institutions are aligned in our belief in the power of the humanities to create new knowledge and contribute to the common good. We also share a history. In the early 1970s, the American Academy formed a planning committee to explore the development and creation of an Institute for Advanced Humanistic Studies. That, by 1978, became the National Humanities Center in North Carolina. It's wonderful that our two organizations continue to find opportunities to collaborate as we have today. I'm especially grateful to National Humanities Center President Robert Newman for his enthusiastic embrace of this report and for moderating today's discussion. Robert has been president and director of the NHC since 2015, and his tenure has been dedicated to broadening the center's scholarly mission, programming, and educational outreach, as well as encouraging vibrant public engagement with the humanities. Prior to joining the National Humanities Center, Robert was Dean of the College of Humanities, Professor of English, and Associate Vice President for Interdisciplinary Studies at the University of Utah. He's a scholar of 20th century English literature and American literature, culture, and narrative theory, and has been awarded for his scholarship as well as his administrative leadership. Robert, it's my pleasure to turn things over to you.
Thank you so much, David. And it's a pleasure to join the Academy. As David indicated, the Academy was instrumental in the formation of the National Humanities Center 43 years ago. So it's a special delight to be partnering with the Academy on this discussion today. The Humanities Indicators report is indeed quite interesting and indeed quite revelatory. And my distinguished panelists will attempt to unpack some of its nuances today. So let me introduce them to you. Rebekah Paré is the Associate Dean for the Letters and Science Career Initiative and the Executive Director of SuccessWorks at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. In this role, Rebekah oversees the college-wide enterprise intended to enable all students to enjoy rewarding careers and satisfying lives. Under her leadership, students' participation in career preparation has improved fivefold. Career outcomes have improved by 14%, and faculty engagement has increased. Rebekah is a humanist herself, earning a BA from the University of New Hampshire and a master's in German literature and musicology from Wisconsin. Pam Hendrickson is vice chair of the Riverside Company, a global investment firm founded in 1988. Pam has been at Riverside since 2006, where she monitors and manages policy, political and legislative risk, while supervising several funds and sitting on its investment council. Pam is vice chair of the board of the American Investment Council, vice chair of the advisory board of the Keenan Institute for Ethics at Duke University, and a trustee of the National Humanities Center. She studied policy and history at Duke University before completing an MBA at the Kellogg School at Northwestern. And Vinson III is the provost and executive vice president at Case Western University, where his Think Big strategic planning initiative has received national attention for its innovative and inclusive approach to planning. He has held faculty positions at Penn State and Johns Hopkins, where he founded the Center for Africana Studies, and he was dean of arts and sciences at George Washington University. Ben is a historian of Latin America, an award-winning author, an elected member of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, and chair of the board of the National Humanities Center. So welcome to all of you. And Ben, I'm going to start with you in terms of the questions. This report indicates that 90% of humanities majors are satisfied with their lives. 90% are satisfied with their jobs. And 74% of graduates are satisfied with their salaries, all of which is comparable with other fields. So I have to ask, where does the negative perception of postgraduate life for humanities majors come from? And also, why is it so persistent?
Robert, first of all, thank you. Thank you for the introduction. And let me start by saying that for me, I'm not at all surprised by these findings. One of the things we've got to remember in terms of the humanities is that one of the goals of humanistic inquiry is life fulfillment. And so it's encouraging to me to see that one of these goals is actually being realized and evidenced in the report. But let me clue you in on a conversation I had yesterday at lunch with the provost of the Cleveland Institute of Music, Scott Harrison. We were having lunch yesterday. We were talking about two undergraduate students at the conservatory. Both of them went on to careers outside of music. One became a dentist, getting a degree from Case Western Reserve University. Another went on to be a businessman. And he said something that I think is illuminating to our conversation. The dentist said that he did not regret a single day his going to a music conservatory because the skills he acquired there, the rigor of learning, mastering that instrument, is something that translated well into his professional development as a dentist. Now, the businessman said that some of the work that he engaged in, especially learning to play Beethoven, he said that's much like what it's like to be in business, taking complex data, and in this case, sheet music, and then translating that to an audience. I find these incredibly fascinating analogies, but there are a number of origins for the negative perceptions about post-grad life for the humanities. And some of this has to do with what David mentioned in terms of the salaries, especially those initial salaries for humanists that they receive after graduation. We know that they lag behind STEM grads. And that's very much true, especially for that first decade after receiving the BA. Another reason, I think, has to do with the rhetoric of humanists themselves. Humanists don't often think of themselves as career-oriented in quite the same way as other disciplines. Now, when you pancake on top of that, the power of media and the coverage, the focused coverage on the STEM and the focused kind of subordination, if you will, in recent years of the humanities, as we move forward in this technological, hyper-technological society, pitting the humanities in a zero-sum game against STEM, that's not helping things. And finally, at least, or another issue is that it's hard to pin down a career path of a humanist when they're going through and getting their BA. Those career paths are isometric. There are multiple career paths. A historian can go in 50 different ways at least. It's not the same in some of the other fields. This leaves a lingering cloud of doubt for career-oriented undergrads and their parents who are paying high tuition. And we know these headaches. We hear these headaches all the time. But I would say in closing, Robert, if you ask me, the problem may be even deeper because I worry about elementary school. I worry about some of the crowding out of the broad humanities in some of the lower grades, especially in public schools, especially as school boards and parents and teachers prioritize STEM. This may come at the expense of some deeper work in history and literature and related fields. The focus on skill mastery, how to read it, how to read, how to write an essay, sometimes causes some loss of sight for some of the deeper gains and exposure to the humanities. So these are some of the things that at least I see from my view, Robert.
Well, thank you, Ben. So Rebekah, one less encouraging trend that's revealed in the report is that a small percentage of humanities students think their job is closely related to their degree. And only about 40% indicate that they would choose to major, that they indicate they would choose to major in something else if they had to do it all over again. So where's the source of the disconnect here? And how might we help our students make a transition to a more satisfying career?
Thank you so much, Robert. And again, thanks for having me today. You know, I think about this question so much in the work that I do every day. And, you know, I believe strongly that our students, again, I'm going to be speaking from a large, you know, public research institution, you know, our undergraduates aren't always recognizing that they are developing in-demand skills that can be applied to all of these career paths that Ben just alluded to, right? 50 different options for a history major. And, you know, they don't recognize them because we're not talking about them in the classroom. We are not helping students recognize the skills they're using as they're doing the type of reading, critical reading and analysis as part of their courses. So I think what happens then is students just think about the content and they equate that content with what they're doing in the job, and they don't necessarily see a direct relationship between, you know, studying revolutionary America, you know, and working in business, right? Sometimes we don't make those direct connections without some assistance. And then they compare themselves with students who are in vocationally tracked majors like marketing or nursing, where that direct connection is really clear. You know, I think one thing that we want to think about is that, you know, our faculty are our number one source of career advising. We see that over and over. And I think in many cases, our faculty weren't always taught, you know, what are those transferable skills that are being developed in the courses in these majors? And when I talk to faculty about this, you know, I get a lot of questions about, well, what is the right terminology to use? Should I talk about it this way or should I talk about it this other way? So helping also faculty identify what is that appropriate terminology so that they can be helping students reflect on the skills that they're learning and appreciate those skills as they leave. And we know that connection between identifying those skills and seeing how marketable those skills are will lead to direct, I think, satisfaction with the overall degree experience. That connection, I think, is really important. But in terms of like, how can we help students make a transition? You know, I think we need to own as university, you know, leaders and faculty and staff and advisors that our students' primary motivations for going to college is to get a better job, to advance their careers, to develop skills that they can use in the workforce. And helping students on this journey needs, I think, to be a really collective effort. And so, you know, I think we really need to grab on to university leadership and faculty and administrators, as well as the career advising space, to all work together to help students see these connections and to capitalize on them.
Thank you so much, Rebekah. So Pam, you are the person outside of an academic setting on this panel. So let's draw on your wisdom a bit. And the Humanities Indicator report on the workforce and beyond tells us that about 11% of managers have a bachelor's degree in the humanities. So what is it about an education in the humanities that lends itself to management? And also a sort of corollary question, do the hiring processes allow consideration of those skills?
So I think one thing that is going to help is the tremendous impetus towards diversity and inclusion in the business world, in my world, because I think that one thing that is going to be common is that people are going to look for different kinds of skills and in different places in order to fill out their hiring class. But in terms of the skills, I agree with what both Ben and Rebekah said. I mean, I think humanities teaches you critical thinking and analytic skills, your ability to take a whole bunch of information, distill it to its essence, and make a decision quickly. It teaches communication skills. I mean, I can't tell you the number of people who cannot write an English sentence. When I was at JP Morgan, I was asked to rewrite a section of the annual report because the division had didn't like it. And he said, oh yeah, I think she was like an English major, in a sort of a derogatory way. Well, A, I wasn't an English major, and B, it was really just a matter of being able to take the information, understand what it meant, and tell it in a way that people could understand what you're talking about. So I think in terms of leadership skills, empathy is something that humanism teaches a lot. And your ability to understand what people want, what people desire, and then to translate whatever it is that you're doing into something that is something people want makes a huge amount of difference. So I think obviously the humanities are critical to your ability to do any of those things. But there is no question that certainly in my world, which is finance, there is a very prescriptive view that you will study economics or you will study something else. By the way, my children did not, but anyway, they, you know, grew up with a mother who didn't. Lloyd Blankfein, who is the CEO of Goldman, studied history, and Brian Moynihan, who's the CEO of Bank of America, studied history. So there is empathy, but Rebekah, I think what you said is right. I think we don't talk about the skills that history teaches you, the skills that English teaches you, the skills that music teaches you. And so it's really more of a focus on skills than it is on the actual thing that you studied, whatever that was.
Thank you, Pam. Let me just continue with that thought. When I was a dean at a flagship public university, I would go around to the major employers of our students at the University of Utah and ask them what, in their entry-level positions, what were the skill sets that they saw most lacking? And almost to a person, the number one skill set that they saw was lacking were writing/communication skills. And the second, interestingly, was the ability to make connections, to sort of think outside of a box, as it were. You know, they would say over and over again that they could teach the technical stuff on the job, but those kind of foundational skills were what they sorely were missing. And of course, those problem-solving skills are so fundamental to the humanities. It also seems to me that the humanities possess a kind of unique ability to connect the intensely personal to the more sort of collective, broadly collective things. So I want us to get personal for a minute. And I want to ask each of you, what have the humanities done for you in your own very varied and successful careers? So Rebekah, if I can start with you, please.
I am one of those humanities graduates that would do it all over again. I spent a lot of time fighting with my parents about my piano performance degree. I can tell you that and where that was going to take me. They no longer fight me on that anymore. but I'll say, I think, you know, my background in performance has helped me tremendously in terms of, Ben alluded to this. I love the stories he was telling us about those two music graduates, right? The ability to take a 30-minute Beethoven sonata and break it down into four beat sections and work those pieces out and combine them. And so this ability to create these small building blocks and build upon them is sort of the hallmark, you know, in many ways of project management. So, you know, I've never been afraid of a big challenge because I can see patterns and ways that I can break projects down, I think, really easily. And I attribute that completely to my performance background. And then music and music theory, the critical analysis, pattern recognition skills have all helped me in the data analysis that I need to do for my work on a regular basis. And German and music has also taught me wonderful communication skills. I loved what Pam was saying about empathy and certainly working in participating in foreign language learning and going overseas. I lived in Germany for a couple of years, that sense of, you know, trying to assimilate into culture that you don't necessarily feel belongs to you, I think is an experience I will always take with me. And then I can use that when I'm working with people who are different than I am, and recognizing their levels of comfort and also adapting the ways in which I communicate or organize or lead. And so that cultural competence, I think, is also really important. So those are just a few examples. I could talk about this all day, but I will let others have a turn.
Sure. Pam, and then Ben.
So similar to Rebekah, I mean, I think it's so many things, but one example that strikes me in particular, I was testifying at a congressional hearing, and regardless of your political views, testifying in Congress is an incredibly intimidating prospect because just the setting, et cetera. And so I'm watching as all of these people are citing statistics and all the Congress, you know, all the representatives are falling asleep in their chair and sitting back like this. And so I said, you know, with my sort of empathy and humanist background, I'd like to tell you a story. And I told the story of a little company that we owned in Virginia and how that company had created 61 new jobs and et cetera, et cetera. And all of a sudden, everyone's sitting on the edge of their chair and paying attention to what I'm saying. So I really think that we need much more focus on the skills that we're learning and less focus on whatever it is, whether it's, you know, musicology or history, or it's those things that we're being taught, that whether it's ability to break down a problem, whether it's the ability, over the weekend, I had two investment committee memos. One, the company made gnocchi, and the other one was a company that does software for wellness in the public works group. And so you're reading these and you're not looking at the numbers. You're trying to figure out, is there a market? Is anyone going to buy this? Is it going to work? And those are things that you would learn only from humanities.
Wow, you guys are taking me down memory lane here. And I'll never forget, Robert, for me, and something that I encourage students that I have a chance to interact with. One thing about the humanities that I learned is this point that you've been making about interconnectivity. I'll never forget when I was in college, taking what I learned in a philosophy course and then applying that into my archaeology course, parking that into my history course, then going into government, and then accumulating that collective knowledge and my own unique insights as I kind of stewed this stuff together, making that connection through the arc of my undergraduate career. That for me was just a learning moment of how things can come together and how you make the connections. And these disciplines are fertile ground for it. I'm a professional historian. I'm card carrying. And I use that every single day in my career as an administrator. Being evidence-based, drawing from rich and varied, if not eclectic, sources of evidence to arrive at solutions. Appreciating a sense of history to understand the moments that we might be in, to understand and to get out of log jams. Incorporating multiple perspectives, remembering the contingent nature of things, evaluating situations, solutions, understanding, and embracing the gray, Robert, the gray, the ambiguity, and being comfortable with that. Asking, why is it that we do these things this way? All of these are the characteristics of a historical of a history education, and I lean on it every day as an administrator. And I know that there are others in other fields who lean on those skills as well. They may forget what I tried to teach in Latin American History 101, but hopefully those skills will carry through.
Hey, Ben, I think we have a whole new headline, Embracing the Gray, which some folks in Washington need right at the moment.
So let's embrace the gray a little bit and also try to clarify some ambiguity. So I think we would agree that there is a sort of general understanding out there that humanities majors, given that they're so process oriented, and that may be an interesting distinction that we might want to pursue, the emphasis on process rather than product. And I think humanities is very process oriented, not necessarily so product oriented. But given the general understanding that humanities majors make for good employees, what should employers do differently to ensure that these skills are valued when they're looking for new employees in the hiring process? So Pam, I'm gonna go back to you. And then Rebekah and Ben as well.
So I think it's, you made an interesting point, Robert. You said that humanities is very process oriented, not product oriented. I'm not sure I agree with that as a person who employs people. And I think if it was more process oriented in terms of these are the skills that I learned, you know, when I was coming out of school, I said, I have really great analytic skills and really great interpersonal skills. And I was sort of agnostic on the industry. And I think we need to be more agnostic about what we're doing in terms of product. Because what you're looking for is a smart person. And I think what schools need to do with the humanities majors is to encourage them to interview in a better way than they are today, so that they're able to say, my skills, these are the skills I learned as a history major. These are the skills I learned as a music major. I'm great at pattern recognition. I'm really, you know, great at taking a whole bunch of being evidence-based, for example. And I don't think they say that. I think just the kids that I've interviewed have said, well, you know, I'm a history major from so-and-so. And then they don't take it any further. So I think we need to help them. And I don't think we can rely on employers necessarily. I think, so, you know, within certain contexts, you know, I will look for a smart person. I don't really care what they did because, frankly, the geeky person who can run the model, anyone can run an Excel model. I need the person who can communicate and who can translate what the Excel model is telling them into something that makes sense.
Great, Rebekah, Ben?
Yeah, I'd be happy to jump in. You know, I think one of the things that we see a lot with employers and their recruiters, a couple of things. One is that the recruiters were also not taught what skills are what they learned as undergraduates in their majors and aren't adept at necessarily matching majors and skill sets. So what they default to is the path of least resistance, right? So I'm looking for somebody in finance, I'm going to go to the finance major. I'm looking for somebody in marketing, I'm going to go to the marketing major. And so they have very narrow perspectives on who can fill these roles. And we spend a lot of time with employers trying to unpack that with them. What actually are you looking for in terms of skill sets? If we can grab them and do that, we can then begin to take those job descriptions that they've written and rewrite them with the employer to attract a better set of candidates for them that can do a lot of the things, a lot of the skills that we're talking about, right? Who can do marketing and maybe all of these other wonderful things. And so, you know, really having, sitting down with these recruiters and helping them understand the opportunity in front of them is I think critical. And then when they find those successful hires in the humanities, they will come back and they'll come back and they'll come back to try to do it again and repeat that. But it does require really stopping those recruiter, pulling them in and having them reflect with us for a little bit and then being able to showcase what it is our students can do. So I think that that's one of the big things that we need to do with employers. We do here at Wisconsin all the time, as we spend a lot of time working on case making for our humanities and even our social science students.
Robert, can I jump in on this one? I absolutely agree with Rebekah and I absolutely agree with Pam, but I actually also think it's not just the case that the students need to kind of be able to present themselves in a different light. And it's not just the case that the conversation has to be had with the employer. I think the employers and the interviewers themselves, they need some more tools. I think that employers probably need, and interviewers probably need, a humanities rubric in the hiring process. Sometimes I think that when employers are looking for someone, as Rebekah kind of identified, sometimes people know what they think they know what they're looking for. Sometimes, as Pam said, it's technical expertise versus genius. But sometimes these are competing values at play. And we need to make sure that the employer has a way in the moment to be able to kind of pull away from those biases and to dissect a little bit more surgically with a tool. You know, I just think it's too easy sometimes to get sucked in too deep into one or the other of these kind of competing values. And these are truly complementary in many ways. You do want someone with a certain level of expertise. You want someone who has that ability to think outside the box. I've heard it when in my conversations, I have a visiting committee at the university that's industry-based that I work with. And sometimes they say they want a finished product. Sometimes they say they don't want a finished product. All of this stuff jumbles up in the moment of the interview. That's why I think that rubric, that's why I think a tool needs to be developed, a humanities-based a rubric that can help identify and parse through some of this.
Well, what about doing a partnership between a firm and a university, or a bunch of universities, or the National Humanities Center, for example, that does that and do it around the diversity initiative? Because if you keep recruiting from the same group of people, you're going to get the same group of people. So you gotta, now is a good time to be looking for different sorts of people. So I think you're right, Ben. I think if you could find that rubric, it could help a lot.
Pam, if I can just interject quickly as well, I totally agree with you on that. But there's something else too that, you know, is an undertone of the conversation that we've been having, and that I think also employers need to think about too, because yes, the humanities does elevate the game in writing and oral communication, et cetera. But sometimes I think outside, disaggregated from the university, this becomes the summation of the humanities, when actually there's something else that's happening, that there's deeper training that's going on. And that kind of partnership that you're talking about, working with universities or the National Humanities Center and the Academy of Arts and Sciences to develop such a rubric, can get and peel away at some of those other intangibles that will allow us to better match the humanist with a job opportunity. So I want to get beyond the trope or the convenient, they can write, they can read, they can do that. No, there's far more critical thinking going on, and we can help you guys figure that out.
So we're talking about values in terms of the value of the humanities and how to communicate those values more broadly to employers, to politicians, to alumni, to parents, et cetera. Let me start with Ben regarding this question, because it's a question about what university administrators might learn. This report tells us that about 40% of humanities majors would not choose the same major again, but it also tells us about 60% of humanities majors, humanities grads, would do the same major again. We hear a lot about humanities departments being on the chopping block at various institutions when, you know, budgets are tight. We hear about some state legislatures putting in bills whereby they would charge differential tuition and those majoring in liberal arts would have to pay more than those majoring in STEM. So this is all quite problematic. So what might university administrators and by extrapolation, others, employers, et cetera, in financial institutions, whatever, learn from the fact that 60% of humanities grads would do it all over again? Ben, please.
Yes, Robert, that's a fascinating statistic. Now I'm going to wear my hat as cynical administrator and say, the cynical administrator would say, what? You mean 40% of the humanities majors would not do it again? So that means we're going to chop X, Y, Z. I mean, that's what the cynical would do. But in all seriousness, I think what this tells us, Robert, is that, look, even the most esoteric discipline is effectively training individuals for their future. And we need to try our best to preserve the plurality of educational experiences that includes a robust suite of humanities offerings, because there are so many paths to an unknown future. We don't know where that genius Pam is cited is going to come from. That may be a classics major, you know, and I double major in classics and history. We don't know. And so it's incumbent upon us, as we do with our children, to expose them to as many different things as possible so that something catches on, so must the flame of the humanities be kept alive so that we can expose our students and cultivate that genius that comes out of left field that will then move society, propel society in some unforeseen way. That's the message, Robert.
Well, the other question I have for you, Robert, is this is the cynical, geeky private equity part of me. Mm-hmm. Like, did they correlate the age of those people on the 40% with the people who would do it again? I mean, is everyone in this study the same age? Because, you know, if you're younger in your career, you might not realize all of the things you've learned, which you got from your humanities majors.
Yeah, I think that's a good question for Rob Townsend, who put this together. So I don't know the answer to that question, but I think it's a very, very good point. Rebekah, do you have anything to add to this?
Well, I think, you know, definitely to Pam's point, I think one of the things that we see here as our, you know, our youngest graduates, our youngest alumni, I guess, they don't seem to find that deep appreciation that we're talking about until they're much further down in their career. You know, we're thinking about 10 years out. And so it'll be interesting to see, you know, what that discrepancy is. Ben went a little bit to that cynical space, which is, okay, if we have 39% that wouldn't do it again, you know, what would we need to change in order to ensure that students aren't feeling like that major wasn't valuable to them or didn't do what it needed to do for them for their future? And then, I don't know. That future could include career, but it could include other aspects of, you know, life satisfaction. I also, you know, thought it might be helpful to call to attention. On page 20 of the report, for those of you who have the report with you, there's an employer assessment of the importance of humanities skills and recent college graduates preparation. And there is a discrepancy there. So, you know, I think we have employers who feel that these humanities skills that we're talking about are very, very important, but when they're assessing their employees, that assessment is not matching their needs. And I think, you know, what can we learn from that? How do we take that in and evaluate the work that we are doing at the university in these different majors? Are there aspects of the majors that we could strengthen in order to develop things like critical thinking skills, where I think that's one of the largest gaps that we see in the report, just as an example. So those are some questions that I might ask as an administrator on, what ways could we make improvement to diminish that 39%? And I feel that if we don't, that number could continue to grow as long as we don't work together to make some change.
So let's kind of get to those changes a little bit. I think that's a nice, sort of nice segue. So Ben talked a lot about having a humanities rubric in hiring committees or in the hiring practices. I think that's extremely important. But what might we do better within academic departments in the humanities and within the pedagogy of the humanities to better prepare our students for postgraduate life? Where are our shortfalls? Anybody to jump in, please.
I'd be happy to kick this one off.
Sure.
So I think I'd like to come back again to talking about that recognition of skills. If we could help equip our faculty to identify some of the transferable skills that they're teaching, create ways in which they could build in opportunities for reflection. So I'm not talking about changing the curriculum. I'm not talking about necessarily changing course syllabi, at least for this, but an opportunity for students to reflect on, okay, we just finished this large analysis of this work literature. What skills did I use in order to do that? And maybe that's a 250 word short essay that students have to tack on to that final assignment, where they do that reflection and get some feedback on that. I think additionally, we here at SuccessWorks at the University of Wisconsin are looking for ways to help students make connections to opportunities to apply those skills in other ways. And that's a wonderful way to help students realize, oh, wow, I just did this. And now I can see the connection between what my professor was just talking about with these critical thinking skills, right? So finding ways to either simulate jobs, case studies, ways in which students can take these skills and apply them in a different setting that helps students make these connections, identify and recognize these strengths that they're building. And I think that creates a whole appreciation. And I can show, if you don't mind, I could show a slide of one way that we're beginning to help faculty do that. And if Patrick would be willing to show the first slide. What we've done here is we've worked with the English major to take these transferable, their learning outcomes and change them into transferable skills. So now we have a common shared language that we worked on together and identifying some core transferable skills. This doesn't necessarily get to everything, but I think the core ones that we can anticipate from our English major here, ways that students could be supplementing those skills, as well as connections to information about employment opportunities, employers that are hiring in this way. And we're beginning now to build a faculty toolkit that will help the not just the English major but faculty, but all of our majors. The faculty then connect and find ways to integrate assignments into the things that they're doing to just help loop in that reflection opportunity. So that's just one example of one way that we're building this. English was particularly happy. This was coming from the college, interestingly, and not from them, because they felt like they, that we're our Midwest, we don't like to self-promote very much for sure. But, I think that they wanted to see this endorsement of the fact that our English majors are getting this kind of skill. So I think it's putting these pieces together, this helps to create that shared language. It helps to educate faculty in the things that they're also doing and teaching. And I think they're really excited about this. They're really excited to make these connections and then help students see ways that they can integrate it. So that's what I'll leave that there.
I was just going to go to the more tech, the sort of relate the empathy and the technical training. So when you think about a student in STEM, for example, that doesn't necessarily scream humanities at you. But if you're a STEM student and you've never taken a history class, you've never taken an English lit class that shows you how a person ticks, I mean, you're not going to be good at doing what you're doing. So somehow I think the connectivity between why it's important, whether it's requirements that you have as a school, is really critical. But Rebekah, I love what you're doing. I wonder if employers have been given that as well, because it would be interesting for employers as they're thinking about how they're going to attack. I mean, we've been thinking a lot about how are we going to get a more diverse group, because, you know, private equity is not really known for being tremendously diverse. And this would be a good way to do it.
Yeah, thank you, Pam. We're in the process of doing these for all 65 of our majors here in our liberal arts college. And so as soon as I think we have these done, that's part of our next step, is to think about ways in which we can deliver this to employers through some of these conversations I was talking about, for sure.
Yeah, and in terms of how our departments in pedagogy can improve so that we could become better ambassadors for the humanities. And I know, Ben, you've been leading this charge at Case Western. I think an embrace of more interdisciplinary activity that addresses some of the contemporary issues that we're all facing, sometimes dire contemporary issues, you know, issues like immigration or racial injustice or climate change, et cetera. There has to be a humanities perspective in addressing or finding solutions to those issues, or else those solutions will be quite impoverished. So I think that kind of embrace, where we're more collaborators than perhaps acting in silos, is one certain, one definite way to go. Ben, could you respond a little bit to that and talk give an example of what you've been doing?
Certainly. I think you're spot on what we're trying to accomplish here at Case Western Reserve, seeing more interconnectivity, more team building, to humanities majors, working with STEM majors, working with social science majors, all because the problems of our world are way too complex. But not to just do that at a theoretical level, but to get messy. Experiential learning, hackathons, for instance, are very useful tools that can, issues and problems coming from industry or coming from communities being fed to the university, and students creatively grabbing hold of it, and then not only using it in a curricular mode in their curriculum, but even in their extracurricular activities. So that becomes a kind of a wraparound, and the student then emerges not just as someone who's there to learn, but to solve. And the humanist then is seen not just as somebody outside of a team, foreign, strange, alien, but necessary to and fundamental to the team. That's a culture change that I think is coming down the pike for industry if more universities get on board. And certainly that's what we're trying to do here at Case Western Reserve University.
So it's time for us to switch to questions from the audience. And I'm going to pivot from my role as moderator to join you as a panelist and turn things over to Rob Townsend, who oversees the Humanities Arts and Culture Programs, as well as the architect of the Humanities Indicators Project at the Academy. So Rob is going to be the moderator for the Q&A from the audience.
Thanks, Robert. So we've already had some terrific questions. Quite a few questions come in the Q&A section. We certainly welcome more of you to offer them as you come in. The first question came in right as you were speaking at the beginning, Ben, which says, Ben mentioned something culturally specific about the way humanities majors talk about their disciplines. How can we better encourage humanities graduates to be better ambassadors, less self-deprecating, less glib about their academic path? I think, Pam, you mentioned that. Ben, I think... Why don't you start? And happy to share, throw this open to all of you.
Thank you. Thank you, Rob. That's a great question. And so, you know, I think some of it's embedded in the work that Rebekah is doing. I think personally, all humanities majors and some of the work of the Academy in this regard with Humanities Indicators should have a little bit of a cheat sheet. Right? They should have a little bit of like a, you know, an elevator pitch that they can refine over time. I think it's incumbent upon some of our career counselors and we as institutions have to check in with our humanities majors time to time. And you know, they've got 4 years to develop maybe a paragraph or two by which they can be armed with a very cogent, competent, persuasive, eloquent pitch on what they've done and why it's meaningful. To me, everyone should have that in their back pocket, but humanists especially so. And I think this is something that universities, for faculty, and in conjunction with career counselors, et cetera, can work on as a fundamental tool to help combat this. So that's just one thought.
It's interesting. The second question, which is also interesting because it sort of feeds into the first question, which is, do faculty members in the humanities care about the job market? And so I would be interested to know, both Rebekah and Ben, from both of you, whether you've had pushback on the English, the slide you shared earlier, Rebekah, for example.
We have not. And I thought actually, even when we launched our career initiative, we would get pushback. And instead we've seen faculty really embrace this initiative. Now, does that mean they're running to my office to get involved? No, not yet. They're on their way. We're working on culture change, I think, around this. And some of that, I think, you know, our faculty are very invested in our students. They really do want to see them succeed. But they've never been, many of them, and I think this is particularly true in the humanities, have never worked outside of academia. They've never had to make this kind of case. They've never seen what this process and this challenge is as an undergraduate, trying to summarize your experiences in a compelling way and make a good business case for why you could be employed, right? They've not experienced what that's like. And I think they don't always appreciate and understand it. And so I think, I do think that they care. I don't know that they know what to do. And I think that's where those career centers, I think, could play a really great role in helping identify opportunities and set mutual goals that we could work on collaboratively.
Can I build on that, Rebekah? I think you Please. Are absolutely right. Our faculty care about their students. They love their students. They want them to succeed. They want them to go out and be whatever they want to be in life. But they worry. They worry that this trend toward careerism cheapens their disciplines, erodes their academic pursuits, and hollows out, if you will, the humanities in ways that ultimately will spell their demise. Now, truthfully, the demise of the humanities has been a concern over time. You look back, this has been a worry as far back as I can, my own work, said back to the 19th century at least. So we live in crisis, in a perpetual crisis. But this is something that I don't want to underestimate, because it's critically important to how faculty engage in the university culture, with the curriculum. And when I was at George Washington University, I was trying to champion something called the Engage Liberal Arts, which is this idea of really turbocharging liberal arts with deep experiential learning. And that was met with some of this concern. So this is real, and it's part of the atmosphere. And we, and as administrators and those in business and all of us who interface, must be sensitive to this as we conduct our work, because ultimately it is the faculty who are doing this teaching that really ignites the mind.
I would just add to that, you know, adversity sort of is the linchpin for community. People come together around adversity to combat adversity. And in these days when there's so much sort of myopic rhetoric and erroneous rhetoric about the humanities, I think we see increasingly humanities faculty coming together to try to think of ways to combat that. And there's a great deal more involvement in public engagement activities. I mean, yesterday I invited our congressman, our district congressman, to have lunch with our fellows here at the National Humanities Center. And everybody turned out, and everybody was really interested in what was going on in Washington and how they can get involved. The National Humanities Center has really elevated its public engagement activities. And if you go to our website, we have a space called Humanities in Action, which offers some of the elevator speeches that Ben was referring to and deals with humanities perspectives on some of the most pressing issues of the day. And I think we're seeing increasingly, just in terms of hiring decisions, promotion and tenure decisions, an increased involvement that the scholarship has to translate outside, often outside of esoteric and narrow reception, and has to be explained more broadly and has to connect more with the pedagogy as well. So I think the humanities are making a very concerted effort to be better ambassadors for themselves and also to address some of these major issues that we've been talking about, these crises in the world.
Well, I also think one thing that might help the ambassadorship a little bit is to have some of these people who have a very different career, who have chosen a very different career path, like Blankfein, like Moynihan, say, hey, I was a history major. You know, let's have that be the headline. That goes to sort of the rubric comment from earlier. But I think that could be important.
I agree. I think the storytelling is so important as we think about changing the rhetoric around this. I think that our humanities graduates have gone on and done just awesome things from so many different tracks, right? And their paths have not always been narrow and straight. They've wandered. There's been learning and pivots involved in that process. But they, I think often at the heart of it, really then can appreciate what it is that they did at the university, what they studied. And I think those are stories we want to amplify. We want to get those stories in front of students. We want to get our alumni telling these stories to our students. And when that happens, when students see the opportunities and the different paths they can take, like magic happens. You know, we have students walking out thinking, I never thought I could get a job in this state with my French major. Like, oh my goodness, look at all the things I can do, right? Those types of aha moments, I think we can create simply by showcasing the really wonderful people who graduated and gone on to do great things. They're just inspirations by themselves.
Thanks, Rebecca. Well, the next question is points out that skills that can be transferred are vital, but so is the ability to manage complex sets of information and to communicate results. But so too is actual knowledge. The errors of U.S. foreign policy since Vietnam can largely be ascribed to ignorance. Should we not also make a case for the knowledge gained in studying the humanities, not memorized facts, but deep and empathic learning of other societies, as well as of others beyond ourselves in our own society? And I would say, you know, in our survey of the general public a couple of years ago, we found that cross-cultural skills were something that people felt were really important and valuable in their own personal lives and in their own jobs. And so I guess if you could speak to that aspect of it, it would be very helpful.
I'll lead off because I 100% agree with that question, and I love that that was written down. So I fully agree, and the humanities does accomplish that depth as well. That's, you know, these courses as you move in a major in a humanities major, that depth in just really starts to solidify. And even if you're not majoring, even if you're taking a few courses here and there, I'm always surprised how much material can sometimes be conveyed in the context of a humanities course. And I'll go back to my own teaching days, the surveys of Latin American history, you know, multiple continents of history taught in one semester from literally thousands before BC into like 1800. That's it. That's remarkable. And so I really like that question.
Robert, would you like to offer something on the value of knowledge as well as skills?
Yeah, absolutely. So let me approach the question this way. It strikes me that we have an issue these days with what what is perceived as being useful, how we define usefulness. And we increasingly define usefulness by monetary impact or value alone. So we, in our responses, often get sort of pushed into a rather narrow corner where we're only talking in terms of economic impact. And I think we have to broaden that definition of usefulness in ways that are more inclusive of the humanities. So we've been alluding in this conversation to the usefulness of empathy, the usefulness of imagination, the power of storytelling, communication skills, how we might be creatively thinking outside of the box and making connections of bridging things that are often thought of as disparate in very, very creative ways. Those strike me as very, very useful, in-depth skills that the humanities doesn't stand alone, but it is the core values and what we constitute in the humanities.
I so agree with that, Robert. And you alluded earlier to myopathy. And I think as a country, we've gone to this place that's enormously myopic. And if it's the humanities that will help make people more open-minded and at least willing to listen to one another without shutting the other person down, that would be a wonderful thing.
I think also on those points, Robert, you I think alluded nicely that preparing students for the workforce is really not the only benefit of their humanities major. We're educating students to be fantastic citizens of this country and empowered community members, advocates for causes they believe in, and preparing them to be able to do that as well. And I think that knowledge is enriching, right? To be able to sit on an airplane and have a really fantastic conversation with someone you've never met before and you may never ever see again, but how enriching that is when you think about the course of your life, those moments, to be able to tap into that. Certainly as well as leveraging knowledge to avoid, major errors of US foreign policy or whatever else might be on your plate. But I think absolutely it's really thinking about that big picture. We talk a lot here about satisfying lives, not just the rewarding career part. So important.
Rob, could I throw one last thing in? Rebekah inspired me. And that is just knowledge should, as it accumulates, does deepen inquiry. And that inquiry leads to epiphany, right? That's fulfilling for your own self, but also for society.
Well, from that lofty vantage point to a more prosaic question, which I think is a question a lot of people actually are curious about. And Rebekah, you or Pam, you might know the answer to this, is has the current constriction in the job market or the current tightness, has that been to the benefit of humanities majors?
I'd be happy to start on that. I would say absolutely not, unfortunately. And I think when we saw the constriction of the labor market, particularly for college graduates, we saw a ceasing of hiring in a lot of the industries our humanities students are really interested in. And instead, we saw an real explosion in the technology space. Now, humanities students can go into technology. And so what do we spend a lot of our time doing is really helping students to pivot where they thought, I want to move into international education. Well, that is not going to be, you're not going to be able to do that, in summer of 2020. So what options are available to you, and how do you leverage the skills that you've been developing to pivot to an opportunity that can also help prepare you to come back to international education? And so really having sometimes really challenging conversations to help students really imagine possibilities that were not in their initial direction. And I think that was disheartening for some. When it worked out, it was awesome. I can tell you that right now, the employers are back in droves and hiring in droves across many, many different industries. And so it's really recovered, and our humanities students are, I think, much better positioned. But I think it was a really tough last year, especially for the humanities students.
Yeah, I agree. I've not seen the labor market constriction as a help at this point. It might be in the future, but it's not right now.
Well, perhaps kind of along the same lines, though, one of the other, we've had a couple questions that asked specifically about the issue of sort of interdisciplinary majors, double majors, minors. And I guess I would be curious, just sort of asking, is there efficacy to those? Is there, well, you know, what is the value of that? I feel like I see at least once a week, I see an announcement that there's a new medical humanities program. And so I guess I'd be curious from your perspectives, both as employers and as sort of administrators, sort of what you see as the value of those sorts of interdisciplinary classes, or is it better for a student to double major?
Well, having gone to Duke, which is kind of the, you know, home, or there's a lot of interdisciplinary stuff at Duke, right? So I'm a huge fan of it because I think it also helps to identify some of those skills that we were talking about earlier. Because when you're doing an interdisciplinary major, you're pulling, Ben, I think you pulled, you know, that you're pulling from a lot of different places. And I think that's enormously helpful. So I'm a big fan of interdisciplinary majors, personally.
Mine is quick. I was just going to say, one of the things we're seeing, at least from an administrative standpoint, is our students are coming in demanding that. And so it's causing universities to kind of rethink and rewire. And so that's something that we're seeing in the administrative ranks.
Yeah, I was just going to say that I think double majors or interdisciplinary majors are tremendously efficacious. And if we just sort of focus on the burgeoning field of environmental humanities or medical humanities, for example, we see that kind of passion in students for addressing major issues in the world and trying to find solutions. And the embrace of a humanities perspective with other perspectives is so important. And, you know, just the changes in the pedagogy of first year medical school, whereby you had to focus exclusively on anatomy, and now studying narrative to learn how to take a good case history becomes extremely important. So you have English teachers, English professors often teaching in medical schools. We at the National Humanities Center are conducting a major oral history project with medical students at University of Washington and Duke and University of California, Irvine, where we're teaching medical students how to take good oral histories, and they're interviewing frontline pandemic workers. From custodial staff to receptionists to ambulance drivers, et cetera, and building an archive that is searchable, that could be researched, that's meta tagged, that's keyword searchable, that can also be turned into a fabulous documentary for storytelling so we can look back on the pandemic time and what we might learn from that. Those require humanities skills.
I was just going to add to this. You know, I was an academic advisor in an earlier part of my career, and I'll tell you a story that I saw a lot. I was in the international studies major, and the beginning of student senior year comes in to see me for the first time and says, I'd like to add the international studies major, which is a huge credit load. No way you can complete this major in a year. And so I'd say, you know, why are you coming to this now? And this often, and I mean, it was like clockwork, September of every fall, I'd have a drove of seniors coming in and saying, if it says international on my transcript, I can get a job. And which I said, well, I think we need to have a different conversation than declaring a new major. So I think one of the things that we have to worry about or think about when we're talking and promoting students getting multiple majors is the fact that sometimes students equate that with credentialing that employers really care about. And we know that actually employers don't always care. We heard Pam say this earlier, what the major is, right? And so I think if we can help students be really strategic about matching majors, like you're talking about medical humanities, right? Technical fields, like going into astronomy and astrophysics with English, right? I had an alum who was the former director of the NASA Goddard Flight Center, who told me that the number one issue she dealt with there was that all of the technical team, they had major trust issues because communications between staff were so poor. And so people would hoard information and not share it among the same team. And so if we could pair strategically these really wonderful majors that build these complementary skill sets, as opposed to, you know, majors that are so closely related, but we could get another credential if we add two classes, right? So virtually the same major, you know, helping students think about how to do that really strategically, I think can be incredibly powerful. But I do worry that sometimes students are going after majors as if it's going to help them get a job when they'd be better off sometimes spending their time doing the kinds of experiential learning Ben and I were talking about earlier. That'd be much better use of their time as applying the skills of their one major than adding on majors because they think it's going to particularly translate for an employer as opportunity. So that's my one caveat on that.
Rob, as Rebekah always does, she inspires me. I just wanted to say one last thing too. Maybe we could also look to STEM and see what's going on there to help us think through this interdisciplinary question in the humanities. At my institution, you go to the medical school, you go to School of Engineering, they're talking interdisciplinary, they're talking transdisciplinary. We have interprofessional education in the medical sciences where dentists, nurses, physicians, and social workers are all in the building together, cross-training each other. They're not seeing issues. Humanists, we could take that same kind of approach and the integrity of those disciplines remains. In fact, the training of those students are elevated through that. I just think we should take a note.
Well, Ben, I think that sets a fine tone for as we reach the end of this. We've unfortunately reached the end of our time. So I just want to thank you all for what was truly a terrific conversation. You fulfilled all my hopes and expectations for this. And I just want to thank Ben and Pam and Rebekah for your excellent contributions. And I will turn it over to David for a last word.
Thank you, Rob. And let me join you in saying a wonderful, wonderful conversation. I really enjoyed, learned so much from it. Hope everyone agrees with me on that. So let me join you in thanking Ben Vinson, Pam Hendrickson, Rebekah Paré for their excellent contributions on the panel. And I'm especially grateful to you, Robert, for moderating today and for so enthusiastically embracing the State of the Humanities Report. It's been a real pleasure to partner with the National Humanities Center on this event. We look forward to future collaborations. I encourage everyone in the audience to spend some time with the report. An Academy staff member has linked to it in the chat. I also encourage you to explore the other reports from the Humanities Indicators, which offer valuable information on the state of the humanities in education, research, employment, and American life. So thank you all for joining us and be well.